Penguin Random House Audio presents Private Revolutions. Four Women Face China's New Social Order by Yuan Yang. Read for you by Kai Alexander, Naomi Yang, Crystal Yu, Gabby Wong, and Yuan Yang.
For my maternal grandfather, grandmother, and great-grandmother, who taught me how to tell stories. For Mama and Baba, who gave me a story to tell. Preface. My maternal grandparents married in 1961, amid a man-made famine. On her wedding night, the bride walked home along streets shared by the bodies of the dead. Her colleagues had surprised her with an extravagant wedding gift, a handful of boiled sweets, which she held like gemstones in her pocket. My parents were born after the harvests returned and began secondary school in the 1970s. At the start of each autumn term, my father would pay for his textbooks with barrowfuls of sweet potatoes. My paternal grandparents grew fields of the purple-skinned roots, which came into season in the early autumn and lasted throughout the winter. My father had enough to eat, so long as what he wanted to eat was sweet potato. Every year in the waning days of winter, he would get sick of their creamy caramel orange hearts, the cloying mouthfeel that stuck no matter how they were cooked. He would start dreaming of the watermelon crop, two seasons away. But by the dog days of summer, sleeping with a hoard of watermelons under his bed, he would tire of their watery emptiness and long for sweet potatoes again. I was born in 1990. One of my first words was gaga, the Sichuanese baby talk for meat. Every morning, my maternal great-grandmother would strap me to her back and walk down the hillside from my grandparents' apartment to the village market. She would run her fingers over the thick stems of asparagus lettuce, the fluffy pea shoots, the bumpy-skinned bitter gourds, naming each of them for me. I would wave my fat fist towards the red meat hanging from the butcher's hooks and say, gaga. My great-grandma would smile and buy the meat, and back home she would proudly recount, the little one said she wanted meat. In a country where the gap between rural and urban meant everything, I lived with my maternal grandparents in a place that straddled the two. It was a communist work unit, or danwei, purposefully buried in the mountains of China's southwestern interior to defend against potential attacks from the Soviet Union in the wake of the Sino-Soviet split of the early 1960s when the two states' alliance broke down. In 1964, the government sent a team of engineers to Sichuan province to build the country's first semiconductor materials factory at the foothills of the holy Buddhist mountain of Erme. It was a tiny town planted into the countryside. In the planned economy of the Mao era, the Danwei did not only organize industrial production, but also provided a complete social infrastructure for workers to live within. My grandparents expected their Danwei to take care of them, and it did. Every weekday morning, we would wake around 6 a.m. to the sound of the loudspeakers playing the national anthem. An exodus of workers would make their way from the apartments on the hillside down to the factory near the village square. At lunchtime, they would go back home again to eat. This job-for-life arrangement was called the iron rice bowl. In my grandparents' factory, the rice was even steamed collectively. My grandfather would bring raw rice into the office in a tin lunchbox and place it between his many colleagues' lunchboxes in a meter-wide steaming pot. They would take the boxes home for lunch. We had no running hot water at home, so to shower, the residents of the Danwei would walk downhill past the factory gates and the ping-pong stadium to the communal showers. My grandpa would disappear into one doorway and my grandma and I into another. At weekends, everyone had more time, and women and children congregated in the shower room, an open space without cubicle walls. The showerheads blasted bountiful hot water at high pressure, the steam billowing up the concrete walls. Children took small plastic buckets and toys for playing in the water. It had the atmosphere of a family outing, like going to the seaside. Employees' children went to the primary school run by the Danwei. It was much better than the rural schools nearby. Like the engineers who worked at the factory, the teachers of the Danway School were brought in from cities further afield. In 1978, after Mao's death, Deng Xiaoping took over the Communist Party leadership and began capitalist reforms, beginning the era of reform and opening up. In the 1990s, the government rewrote the social contract, with the broader aim of instilling market competition and preparing China for accession to the World Trade Organization. The government started shutting down and privatizing the old state-owned enterprises. In the decade after 1993, 50 million workers were laid off. Initially, the privatization of the state enterprises was a free-for-all. Managers and local party bosses grabbed assets for themselves while leaving workers with nothing. China experienced a wave of worker unrest. Many of these workers felt deeply betrayed by the state. Under the Danway system, they were a relatively privileged class. Urban workers were accorded great respect under the communist social order. Now they saw their Danways being ripped apart by financiers, party officials, and managers whose status was rising far above their own. But by then, my grandparents were almost retired. Their factory, being of national technological importance, was kept in the arms of the state and remained rich. They expected their Danway to take care of them, and it did. On the other side of my family, my paternal grandparents were peasants. My father, who was born into rural poverty, knew he would do better than his parents, so long as he got off the sweet potato farm. He got into a university on the other side of China, in my mother's southwestern home province. My parents entered Sichuan University in 1981, becoming some of the first students to take up places at the newly reopened universities that Mao had closed during the Cultural Revolution. After they graduated in 1985, the government assigned them to teaching posts at a recently established university on the East Coast. I was born on that coastal campus. Shortly after, my mother moved to another Chinese university to pursue a doctorate in ancient history, while my father left for the UK to do the same in computer science. It was a simple decision for him. All the students who could leave were doing so. Chinese academia lagged behind the West, especially in the sciences, and the Beijing government's massacre of students and workers in Tiananmen Square in 1989 had left many questioning the future of China's universities. But neither of my parents was capable of taking a baby with them. Before my first birthday, my great-grandma took me on the 2-day train ride to Ermei Mountain to live with her and my grandparents. My grandfather had never taken care of an infant before I arrived, because he himself had left home to work in the city of Chengdu, Sichuan's provincial capital, when my mother was small. But he discovered by chance that when I cried in the middle of the night for my mother's milk, he could calm me down by telling me stories. After many months of this, I started telling him stories back. They featured me, my grandma, and grandpa. When I turned 4, my parents plucked me from my home in the Sichuanese mountains and took me to England. In the photo of me leaving my grandparents at the departures gate in Beijing Capital Airport, my grandma stands next to my grandpa, who is holding me in his arms while I cling onto his grey shirt. The 3 of us look dismayed, rather than excited, about my journey to a place with many more opportunities than a small town in Sichuan. From then on, I only visited China in the summer holidays, when I went on the pilgrimage back to my grandparents' home. The whole country to me was encompassed by the smell of white gardenias growing in my grandparents' vegetable patch, the feel of the wet heat of the southwestern Chinese summer. Nothing seemed to change in my grandparents' Danway until I turned 18, when a tarmac road unfurled from it to Ermei's town centre. This was the China I knew before I returned to live there in 2016 as a journalist for the Financial Times. My impetus to return to the country partly came from a desire to immerse myself in the language. I had studied economics with a focus on developing countries, thinking I would work on the problems of poverty. But what we learned in the classroom was far removed from what happened on the ground. I wanted to be there. My parents were supportive. My mother, who had studied ancient Chinese literature and history, had always wanted me to connect to the culture that had been her passion. I moved to the arid northern capital of Beijing, and finally, in my mid-20s, came to know China on my own terms. I booked my own long-distance trains, no longer being shuttled around like a piece of luggage like I had as a child.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.